You're listening to Go Fish with Mike Buck on AM 690, The Fishing Answer. This segment is being brought to you by the Western Pacific Regional Fishery Management Council at WPCouncil.org. Now, troll on in.
Okay, WPCouncil.org, Western Pacific Regional Fishery Management Council, is a regular contributor on the program because they have this mandate to educate everybody. And that's kind of what our next guest does. And he is a regular guest with us, depending on what levels of how many of the hats that he wears is going to be employed on any given day. So he is the fisheries analyst and also the precious corals coordinator. We're not going to really talk about precious corals today. I wish we could. But we're going to talk about a lot of other stuff with Josh DeMello. How you doing? You know, it's always a fun to get together with you because I never really know what job they're going to beat you up with this week because there's so many doing that. Originally, we were going to talk about the Magnuson Act. It was sort of come up on one of the things that we discussed. And I do want to learn more about that today, but particularly because I think it's been in the press, been a couple of stories about this reauthorization, which would indicate to somebody that didn't know like me, oh, does that mean that if it doesn't get reauthorized, it's no longer authorized? Can you, first of all, before we even get into any of that, Josh, explain Magnuson Act 101? What is this Magnuson Act? What does it cover?
So prior to 1976, there were foreign fishing vessels all around the United States. They could fish. They could fish all the way up to the shoreline if they wanted to. Mm-hmm. So they would to get rid of this foreign fishing within the United States areas. Mm-hmm. They created something called the Magnuson Fishery Conservation and Management Act of 1976.
Weren't those boats precluded from being in certain waters anyway, just because we have this claim of local and then federal waters around all of our property?
That didn't come into effect till around the 1980s, okay, with the exclusive economic zone. I believe President Reagan that helped to institute that. But prior to that, foreign fishing occurred everywhere. So basically, the Magnuson Act said we don't want fishing around the United States out to 200 miles. Mm-hmm. Let's get rid of the foreign fishing.
Okay, in a perfect world, who would that be administered or enforced by?
In a perfect world, it would be the communities itself.
Yeah.
And that's sort of how it was set up through the Magnuson, so that we're not managing out of Washington, D.C. or Silver Spring, Maryland, as it is now, and we're actually managing it locally within our jurisdictions.
Okay, so this act was designed to tell foreign vessels, look, you're in our waters, and these are our fish. You can't fish here anymore. There are consequences.
Right, and to promote domestic fishing so that the fisheries in the United States would build up to be just as good as those in Asia and South America and Europe that have been fishing for millennia, and the U.S. was only 200 years old at that time.
Do some of these countries and some of these people that were coming into our waters and fishing, do they think, hey, we've been doing this for 1,000 years where we live, so don't tell us you're running out of fish. Just fish everywhere.
They still do, even today. Mm-hmm. They're probably the biggest fishing industries in the world are not from the United States. Mm-hmm. They are from these other countries.
Yeah, and you know, it's hard for a country that wants to call itself the leader in this, the leader in that, to have to admit, well, we might not be the leader in fishing. You know, there might be people catching way more fish than we are, more efficiently.
But at the same time, we're still the responsible country that wants to be out there and show them that we need to take care of our resources and this is the way we should be doing it.
Okay, so that means if you're talking, because it's a federal law, right?
Right.
And it has, I would imagine, the force majeure, the effect of any other law, meaning that if you are in violation of any provision of that, there are consequences. That's why we say, when I asked you about enforcement, sometimes there's so much water to cover, it must be a very difficult act to enforce.
And that's the responsibility of both the United States Coast Guard, which has a fisheries enforcement section, as well as the NOAA Office for Law Enforcement.
I think ever since 9/11, a lot of different peoples and different agencies were sort of forced to cooperate with each other a little bit more and get more involved. And you say the Coast Guard, boy, that's a really busy group of people, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah. Especially in this 14th district, which is the biggest one. And that being said, when we talk about the Western Pacific Regional Fishery Management Council, that would suggest that there are others. and we are part of a much bigger picture.
Right. There's actually eight of us, and it was created through the Magnuson, these eight regional fishery management councils, which include North Pacific, Pacific, Gulf of Mexico, South Atlantic, Mid-Atlantic, New England, and the Caribbean.
Yeah, so that means that we literally have predators that would be ready to jump in on any of those areas if it weren't for the Magnuson Act.
Exactly, especially those that border other countries such as Alaska and the North Pacific. There's Russia right across the Bering Strait.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and we've talked about this before. Put on your other hat for a minute, being a fishery analyst. And that means that, you know, a fish is not quite certain what zone it's in or where it is. I mean, it's just a fish.
Right. You can't tell a fish not to bite the hook.
Yeah.
So, the only thing we can do is control fishermen and fishing behavior.
Yeah. And you also can't tell a fish, okay, don't go outside that line because that's where you're going to get caught, or inside this line. They just swim. They're just fish. They need our help. Let's talk about some of the other stuff, though, because I think the process of how the Magnuson Act works is interesting as to what it does cover in each individual section of the fishery. Is it the same everywhere?
It is basically the Magnuson, we like to say, is our Bible.
Mm-hmm.
It has our creation story of how the councils came about, but it also has our commandments, which are the national standards by which all of the councils have to abide by when making rules for fishing.
I know that one of the biggest things in Hawaii has been, and you know, being a local boy yourself, you know that anybody that's trying to tell us what to do from far away is resented. That, you know, and the council, the Western Pacific Regional Fishery Management Council, is the only vehicle that local people can put in their ideas and their concerns and their thoughts. Are there still a lot of people that misunderstand when rules are made that we don't have any say in it, that we do?
There is, and there are some issues that take national precedence over what we're doing locally, and there's ways for the fishermen to actually get involved through the council so that their voices can be heard.
Yeah. I think that maybe, and this has been, I know that we've been very, very happy and pleased about the upsurge in attendance at the Fishers Forum, because I think that people are, I don't want to say they're desperate, but they're clinging to hope and saying, hey, don't keep taking stuff away from us, you know, listen to us too. And yet I sort of got the feeling the last time, and I think you did, is that some of these people that have that attitude are willing to at least fess up to or own up to, hey, wait a minute, we can't just go willy-nilly. We have to have some rules. We have to have some controls.
I think that's the type of environment we're in right now, where people are starting to understand that what our grandfathers did, what our ancestors did might not have been the greatest, you know, taking turtle eggs or taking loads and loads of fish. You go down to the fish markets or the fishing stores, and you see all these old pictures of people with tons of fish on the driveway, and you don't see that too much today. You get a couple now and then, but it's nowhere like it used to be. And
yeah, I agree. You know, I mean, or if you do see it, they're all in buckets of ice. Before, it used to be just laid out on there, and you know doggone well that there's no way all of that fish is going to get eaten.
So right.
It's going to get bad before it can get chopped up. But the bottom line is, why should people here care about a federal law? Because the Magnuson Act doesn't really affect the fishermen here. I mean, you know, he's fishing. I shouldn't say that. What, if any, parts of the Magnuson Act does affect the fishermen here?
So every time the Magnuson gets reauthorized, and it has been pretty regularly every 10 years, but there are bills that once in a while will stick things in Congress that may affect the Magnuson Act. But there are parts that got stuck in there, like essential fish habitat in 1996.
Mm-hmm.
Now the federal government has a nexus to consult with any project dealing with federal money or in federal areas of the ocean. So if you're building something, you're changing a dock, the essential fish habitat rule comes into effect, where they have to consult with the National Marine Fisheries Service. In 2006, that reauthorization put in the annual catch limits. So as your listeners have heard before about the bottom fish annual catch limit, that's a great concern, because that was something that was put in because it works in other areas, like Alaska. But for Hawaii, it has been working not too bad. I mean, there's some people that are mad about it, but it's probably not the the magic stick to
Well, you
to
know,
use.
That we actually talked about this real recently, too, and that is a couple years back when the total catch limit was designated, it surprised a lot of the bottom fishermen because it was for the same of what they've been catching. In other words, they weren't telling them to catch less. But now there's more statistical data available saying that the fishery is a little bit challenged, so some of these were decreased. But I didn't get the resentment that we got the first time around where there was going to be limits. Do you see that at the council level? Do you guys see that in the fishery that, you know, so maybe fishermen aren't happy right now that the numbers have been reduced for the bottom fishing for the next few years, but they realize maybe there's a reason?
I think they definitely know that there's a reason why we're doing this kind mm-hmm. of stuff. They're not happy with how they're coming up with the numbers. They're not happy mm-hmm. with the numbers.
That's a good point.
But they understand why we need it. And I think that's been that change that we've been seeing in the past maybe 5 years or so, that fishermen are getting more involved in that process.
Your hat on the fishery hat, the analyst hat, has a lot to do with the quality of research that you're able to look at and everything else. I don't know if it's appreciated in leaps and bounds, but the last couple council meetings and forums have shown that are, thank goodness, because of technology, we're able to pretty much zero in a little bit better than we used to on some of these numbers that are vital for what you guys are doing.
And the Magnuson Act says that we need to use the best available science to manage mm-hmm. the fisheries.
Yeah,
that's one of our national standards. And the best available science isn't always the only science there. Mm-hmm. There's sometimes other science that's out there, but it may not be the best available.
It's kind of interesting because, as you know, I've got another discussion we just had a little while ago with Carlton Nakaoka from Fin Addict about a new tournament that POP is sponsoring, and we're just recently at the council level talking about the value of the data from tournaments, because it happens kind of at the same time, kind of at the same place, and kind of with the same number of boats every year. This is another tier of information that is valuable, huh?
And it's very cogent to our discussion, because mm-hmm. the Magnuson reauthorization that's currently happening in Congress is looking at things like stock assessments and data collection, mm-hmm. trying to improve that flow of data so that we're making the right decisions mm-hmm. for the fisheries.
I had to laugh because, as you know, every time the TV network needs increased revenue, they throw on Shark Week. Mm-hmm. And we're right now going through Shark Week again. And it's interesting to see the amount of attention that is being paid to not finning anymore. I mean, remember the last couple of Shark Weeks or months, years back, they were showing these, particularly in the Orient, these rooftops. They were just strewn. And I guess that would reflect on a real quick question about this whole thing about the sea cucumbers. You know, we've all been through that recently. How did you guys react? Because I know it's not a big food thing or anything. It hasn't been in the past. But doesn't it show kind of quickly what decimating a particular stock can do to the ecosystem?
Better yet, it shows the management scheme and how reactive it can be mm-hmm. to events such as the harvest of sea cucumbers. Yeah. And
who would have thought it, right? I mean, you know,
right.
And all of a sudden they become valuable.
They have been valuable in other parts of the Pacific. Mm-hmm. There's rules in Fiji and American Samoa and in Saipan, other areas that we manage. So we're aware of these problems, but prior to this harvest, mm-hmm. there hasn't been anybody really looking to bag them up and send them over to China.
Hey, I can tell you one thing. People reacted very, very positively to the quickness in which the state was able to get a stop to look at this. And if we made some mistakes, let's stop making them. Because the real bottom line is, and this is where the science part of what you do would be valuable, is that you don't know the day that you go out to, say, you know, Kaneohe and you take 8 million cucumbers out of the water. You don't really know for a while what effect that has.
Exactly, and I think there are a couple of people that are actually doing assessments of sea cucumber populations in Hawaii, mm-hmm. and I don't think they're completely done with it, but it's not looking too good mm-hmm. where we can actually take that many and still have a viable ecosystem.
I would imagine that half what you do, the fun of which is being able to really understand what happens in a particular area. This species, that species, you know, if you take, you know, there's kind of a fine balance. I don't know who figured this out in the very beginning, but it was pretty good. And so that must mean that this issue maybe called a lot of attention to a lot of us that, that aren't aware of how valid, how problematic it could be. So maybe when somebody sees somebody with bucketfuls of stuff, they'll know, oh, I better call. I better call DLNR. I better find out about this.
And the fun part, I guess, is the knowing how everything works, knowing the system, knowing the Magnuson, knowing how the state works, how Congress works, and then hearing from the community on what the issues are and the passion and the emotion that goes into some of these areas that, that have problems with it, harvesting issues, and then trying to figure out a way to get everything into the same page so that we're all either benefiting or suffering equally.
Yeah, but you know, one thing that I got, and you said earlier, and this is, it would bear just another little thought about, you talk about maybe if we look at our kupuna and their kupuna and say that some of the things they were doing may not have been responsible to the planet, but by the same token, when you go back real far back, a lot of the things that they were doing were pretty doggone on, right on, considering they had no technology. They just had this feeling or experience in an area so that they knew at least in that area when to take the species and when not to.
And that's something that I'm kind of getting into that in that part of it. It's trying to interest me more and more is how do we shift from this ancient system, my family's traditional system going back hundreds and hundreds of years, and bring it into the new era where there's new equipment, new technology, new rules, new systems. How do we get those two to mesh?
Yeah, I was watching something which I thought was really fascinating on Shark Week once again, because I'm a magnet to that. I just keep watching it because it's so interesting, and it's getting a lot more scientific. And you can see how technology has really helped with surveying. They tagged a thresher shark in this thing I saw the other day. They're unbelievable the way they use their tail to stun their prey and eat and everything. But more importantly, it shows that there are so many young people that are coming in and finding a gig and then being respected for what they do. These old guys driving the boats that had no idea how to computerize something, there's this little 17-year-old girl on the back of one of these boats making major decisions.
Right, and that's all about building local capacity. And if we can get more of our young local kids into fisheries or some kind of science or other program that they come back and they can contribute to the fisheries, that'd be great.
Yeah, but look at your own case. For those that don't know, I'm not sure that you thought that this was going to be as major of a commitment as it's turned out for you when you first started it, right?
No, when I was going to school, I was looking at oceanography.
Yeah. However, I'm telling you that one of the things that we've talked about a little bit before, and that's why I was so glad to see some of these people come up, is when you say that you're now getting more interested in looking at the past for some of these solutions, finding that must be sometimes difficult, and some families may not be all that willing to be communicative.
That's one problem. The other problem is trying to dig through the romanticism of how Hawaiians manage their system. There are certain things that do apply to management now. Yeah. There are other things that probably wouldn't apply. You could, back when you broke a kapu, you were killed.
You can't do that now.
You can throw them in jail, sure.
Right.
But what is that penalty?
Has been one thing that's really echoed through my program over the years that I've been doing this. So many people feel that when you are, you know, caught you've committed an infraction, you've broken a law, you've broken a rule about the environment, specifically about fishing or ocean activities, that the penalties don't seem to fit the crime. In other words, you know, having something being a misdemeanor is kind of a bummer when it's so valuable to the fishery. So maybe some of that, maybe we're awakening up and saying, hey, wait a minute. You know, when we point economic value of, say, lobster or whatever, to have a misdemeanor fine for a lobster out of season doesn't make any sense. It should be, if you get caught with one of these things, it's going to cost you a few grand.
And those kind of things, I think, need to be taken case by case, too, because there may be some families that are taking it for cow-cow, and there's an over an abundance on their reef, and they know their reef because they know that it doesn't spawn during the summer and it spawns during the winter.
Yeah, that's a good
so
point.
they don't take during
always,
the winter.
It's not always in that R month formula that we have.
Right. That's a generic rule put into place.
Well, like you're saying, it's an exciting time to do that. If is there if somebody does want to know specifically about the Magnuson Act, is there a link, is there a good place on the council website where they can see the ongoing activity or what may or may not come up with this reauthorization? Because you say that is maybe this year, maybe next year, we don't know when.
Not currently, but I think there is one on the National Marine Fisheries website. Mm-hmm.
By the way, this is like, Josh, you sent me this thing, and it's like, good luck with that. If they want it, they better email me, and I'll email them the link. But go ahead and say what it is.
It's www.nmfs.noaa.gov/MSA2005.
And a partridge in a pear tree. But if somebody interested in that, I will make sure they get it.
And we'll be working on something for our website as well, wpcouncil.org, so that when there are things for the Magnuson reauthorization, we can have you folks take
there
a look.
There you go. As always, Josh, thanks for joining us. Nice seeing you again.
All right. Thank you, Mike.
Okay, that's going to wrap up this episode of Go Fish. Thanks for being a part of the party. If you'd like to hear something on the program in the future, feel free to drop me an email. Best way to do that is themikebuckshow@aol.com. Have a great rest of your weekend. We'll see you next time. In the meantime, guidelines, big bites, sharp hooks, put it in the box. Take what you need and leave what you don't. See you next time. Aloha.